Let's put our knowledge now to a good use. So therefore we will create a non-trivial program. And as part of programming, it's also important to firstly analyze existing programs, but it's also important to design algorithms and then implement them in code. In this little program that we do, we will try to sum up the numbers between 1 and 10. So we want to print the result of 1 plus 2 plus 3 and so on up to 10. So how do we do that? First of all, we create a little C program that has the typical structure, including our standard io.h file, a main function returning 0 from it, and then we get started. We need obviously the variable sum, which is 0, and at some point we want to print the value of sum. And let's do this. So it's always a good idea to start with a very tiny program and then move forward and ensure that it works in every step, instead of writing a huge program and you never get it running because it has a lot of bugs. So let me compile this program and run it. Well, it prints sum equals 0. So now we didn't sum up yet the numbers between 1 to 10. So how can we do that? Well, a very naive strategy would be, of course, to take sum and add 1 to it, then add 2 to it, then add 3 to it, and so on. This is very tedious, but I have seen a lot of codes from people doing things like this. Instead, it looks really like we need to repeat something here. We need to repeat to add the values between 1 and 10, right? So we need an iteration construct. The for loop is very much well suited for this task, as it works really good, well with a known number of iterations. And how often do we want to iterate? And where do we start from? Well, we start from I equals 1. We want to iterate until I is bigger than 10. And well, as long as I is less than 10, you could say, this is exactly what I put here. And so we increment I by 1. So now this counts from 1 to 10. And now all we need to do is to add to sum the value of the variable I. So let's compile it and let's run it. So the sum is 55. You can believe me, that's the correct answer. So the problem here would be rather simple if we just sum up numbers from 1 to 10, but let's expand a bit from it. Instead of summing up the numbers, we want to sum up the square of the numbers between 1 and 10. So the result should be 1 square plus 2 square up to 10 square. Well, what do we need to change? Obviously, we need to change the way we're adding the value. We don't want to add the normal value, we want to add the square of the value. This is, however, not valid code in C, because it means something different, because that is the XOR operator. If you want to square a value, well, you just can write down I times I. Now, this is the square of the value. Let's compile the code again, and let's see that it works. 385. Again, you can believe me, that's the correct output. So now let's work further with this example and say, how about we want to add not only the numbers, the square of the number 1 to 10, but we want to add the square of all even numbers between 1 to 10. So we want to add 2 square up plus 4 square plus 6 square and so on up to 10 square. Well, there are two approaches of doing this. Let's take a simple approach. We keep our loop from iterating from 1 to 10. Now all we need to do is to check for an even number. And if it is an even number, then we add it to sum. So now the question remains, how do we check that I is even? Do you have any idea for it? Think about what you've learned. How could you possibly check that a number is even? Well, a very simple approach, in fact, is the modulo operator. Remember what a modulo operator does. Think about how you could use it for a moment and pause the video again. So the solution is that when I take a number and I divide it by 2 and get the remainder, I can basically see if the remainder is 0, then I know it is an even number. So this code now should do exactly what we need to do. Let's compile it. Sum is 220, you can believe me, that is again the correct answer. So that was one approach, but there is also, like I said, in coding, there's always an alternative. So here's an alternative approach. So in this case, we used our iteration construct, the for loop, but also we used our selection construct, slash the condition, if, to filter out only the even cases. Could we somehow get rid of this if and just live with our iteration construct? Think about it again for a moment by yourself. So the answer is yes, it's very much possible. All we need to do is we change here the condition. Well, and the iteration. So the condition here says we count up to number 10 and the iteration says, well, add 1. But how about we add 2? Now we go only up by increments of 2, which obviously would be every other number, which is kind of what we did here in this check. So the condition we have to check, if we have to adjust it, well, it still goes up to 10. Yeah, that seems to be correct. But how about the initialization? Well, here we initialize from 1. And, well, here we also initialize from 1. Maybe that's correct. Well, like I said, not a big deal. We can always test code. So why not just run it? So let me initialize, reinitialize sum and set it to 0 again. So now sum is 0. And now we again add to sum I square. And let's print the result and see if that's the same output as before. No, it isn't. It's just 165. Why is that? Let's again look what we have written. Well, the code in our loop body is correct. That we didn't change anything here. Also, our iteration is correct. We want to increment by 2. Now, there are only two cases where we can, two parts of this for construct where we can make a mistake. One is the initialization. And one is here, our condition. Think about which one had the mistake here and why that is the case for a moment. So the answer is our initialization is wrong, because before, when we start from 1, we actually increment by 2 every time. So we start, we actually count through 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and then we stop. While if we start from 2, well, we actually count 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, which is exactly what we needed to do. So we didn't have to change, in this case, our condition. But nevertheless, it's a good idea to always check that it works. Let's check if this code produces the same output. It does. And you can believe me, it is now correct. So these are very basic examples. You should be able to understand what we have done here by analyzing the code and walking through it step by step, simulating to be the computer, right? Start here being a program counter. You try to perform the operations. Remember that you have these memory cells, you store the values, and then you should be able to reproduce this program and understand what it does. This is really a key to understand coding in the first step, and then in the second step, you need to develop this kind of creativity and practice to write your own codes.